Welcome to this particular module, which is related to the process hazard and identification. In the previous modules, we have studied about the concept of hazard, risk, and there are different methodologies through which we can identify the process hazard, which is available at the workplace. Now, in this particular module, we are going to study with the various definitions related to this hazard identification. What is the hazard at workplace? How we can identify the specific hazard present at workplace through a systematic methods? And we will study about the concept of process hazard checklist, because checklist is extremely important while calculating the assessment or we are performing the assessment of hazard present at workplace. So, let us discuss about some important definition. Now, first thing is that what is safety? Because ultimate aim is to have a process safe. So, the safety is the freedom of injury, damage or loss of resources. Now, another is the hazard. Although we have gone through the hazard definition in the previous modules, but here is the more specific definition of hazard. The condition that can result in or contribute to a mishap. Now, it is the potential to cause harm. Harm including ill health, injury or even fatality or damage to the property, plant, product or the environment. Sometimes it may lead to the production loss or increased liability. So, ultimately it will turn into the economic loss, whether we consider all the aspect or anyone. Now, risk. Risk is the probability or a chance of occurrence of undesired event and the severity of resulting consequences. Now, remember which we talked earlier that the hazard is present everywhere, even the wall may collapse, even the roof may collapse, even the chair on which you are sitting, and risk is the probability whether it will collapse or not. So, in a simplified manner, you can analyze that hazard and risk. Now, once we analyze this hazard and risk, there is a concept of risk assessment, that is a process of qualitative risk categorization or quantitative risk estimation, so that we can analyze that what is the economic loss and what is the impact of that particular risk to the plant and the environment associated it. Now, risk management, that is the process of risk identification, risk assessment, risk disposition and risk tracking and control. The probability, that is a chance or the likelihood of occurrence of an event or a particular event. The reliability, that is the probability that an item will perform its intended function for a specified mission or profile. So, reliability may be attributed to the different safety devices, different process conditions, etc. Mishap, that is unintended event that can cause injuries, damage or loss of resources. So, once we gone through or we are acclimatized to all these definition, let us have the look about the hazard. This is not always identified until an accident occurs. So, obviously, when the roof collapses, so, you would not be able to identify the hazard unless it collapses. So, essential to identify the hazard and reduce the risk well in advance of an accident, that is the prima facie requirement, so that you can minimize the losses, you can minimize the loss in production, you can minimize the economic aspect. So, for each process in chemical plant, you need to frame several set of questions. And you must have answer for all those questions. Now, these a sample set of questions are enlisted, that is, what are the hazard? What are the hazard present at your workplace? How you can identify those hazards? Once the hazards are present, then what can go wrong and how? And what are the chances? That means you are calculating the risk. And what are the consequences? Again, I am giving back to you another the example that if you are working in a plant or if you are working in a particular room, there may be a chance of that the fan may collapse. So, it can go wrong because sometimes the pin which is holding that particular fan may corroded, may be bented, anything else. So what are the chances? It may fall down on your head, or it may fall down to an empty place. Then what are the consequences? The consequences means you may get injury or you may not. So you have to frame the different set of questions, and you must give the answer of those questions. Now, while categorizing the hazard, there are two type of basic category of hazard. One is the acute hazards. They are having an immediate and obvious impact. That is, for example, risk of falling or being wounded because of the slippery or wet floor. That is the acute hazard. There may be chronic hazard, so having more hidden and cumulative or long term impact. For example, workplace bullying, where the long term impact may result in stress or other psychological injuries. So hazard generally fall into following six groups. So we have enlisted all those six groups. One is the physical hazard, that may be the slippery floor, object in a walkways, excessive noise, fire, etc. There may be certain chemical hazards, that is gases, dust, fumes, vapors and liquid. There may be some ergonomic hazards that may be attributed to the poor design of equipment, workstation design, sometimes postural or workflow problems, manual handling, repetitive movement. Some hazards are attributed to the radiation, that may be attributed to the microwave, infrared, ultraviolet, laser, X-ray, gamma rays, etc. Sometimes in while characterizing the various chemical samples, you may encounter these type of radiative hazards. Then psychological hazards may be the shift work stress, workload stress, dealing with the public stress, harassment, threat of danger, discrimination, sometimes constant low level noise, extreme stress, etc. There may be certain biological hazards, that is the infection by bacteria, virus, fungi, parasites through a cut, insect bite or a contact with the infected person or contaminated object. Sometimes you may encounter with the contagious diseases, etc. Now, let us have some example of various hazards. So, in the first aspect, we are going to discuss some of the electrical hazards. So, they are attributed like shock, burns, overheating, ignition of sometimes combustible, inadvertent activation, sometimes power outage, distribution of back feed, etc. Sometimes it may be attributed for unsafe failure to operate, sometimes it may lead to the explosion, electrical, sometimes electrostatic charges built up, etc. Sometimes explosion of or electrical arc, etc. So these are the certain hazards attributed to the electrical one. Let us have a look of some mechanical hazards like sharp edge points, there may be pinch points, rotating equipment. Sometimes it may be attributed to the lifting weights, slide limit stops, assembly sequencing, hinged access panel. Now, how is the rated load enforced? That is again a big question. Then reciprocating equipment, etc. There are certain examples of pneumatic hydraulic hazards like overpressurization, safe deep pressurization, reverse installation, pipe vessel duct rupture. Sometimes tank may burst because of the overpressure. Then sometimes the pressure and leakage, sometimes implosion, mislocated relief device. That is why the location of relief devices are extremely important. The proper location of relief devices are extremely important. Sometimes there may be chances of dynamic pressure loading. The relief pressure may sometimes improperly set, then it may be catastrophic. Then backflow and a cross flow impact, accidental cross connection. So there are so many pneumatic and hydraulic hazards. Now sometimes hazards may be attributed to acceleration, gravity hazards like loose object translation, sometimes due to impact, sometimes the falling objects may lead, sometimes inadvertent motion, then fragmentation, etc. So these are the hazards related to the acceleration. Then sometimes there may be certain examples of temperature related hazards, that is the failure of heat source or sink, sometimes hot and cold surface burns, pressure elevation that may attribute it to the temperature effect. Sometimes the vaporization of confined gas and liquid, this may lead up to pressure enhancement, elevated flammability and velocity reactivity, etc. This may cause the temperature hazard, etc. Sometimes freezing humidity, moisture, etc. So these are the couple of examples related to the temperature hazards. Now we may look into the some fire and flammability hazards, like hazards attributed to fuel. It may be one of the best examples that sometimes it is all says don't play with the petrol, don't play with the diesel or any kind of thing, because it may be extremely dangerous. Ignition source, sometimes it may lead to the certain oxidizers, there are certain propellant, radiation, etc. So these are the certain things which are related to the fire and flammability hazards. There are certain examples related to the radiation hazards. There are certain components like laser, waveguide joints, different type of klystrons, then cavity resonators, antenna horns, antenna forms, etc. Because in past there are certain accidents, they are attributed to these lasers. Sometimes they are categorized in terms of non-ionizing and ionizing one. Non-ionizing, they are like laser, infrared, microwave, high frequency, ultraviolet, etc., high power frequency. Then ionizing one, alpha, beta, neutron, gamma, X-ray, etc. So specifically when you are using these type of radiative assisted reactions, or sometimes you are performing any kind of characterization streams like UV spectrophotometry or laser guided spectrophotometry, then definitely you have to look into these type of hazards. So workplace hazard also include the practices or conditions that release uncontrolled energy, like object that could fall from height, that is potential or gravitational energy, runaway chemical reactions attributed to the chemical energy, release of compressed gas or steam, pressure, high temperature, entanglement of hair or clothing in rotating equipment like kinetic energy, or sometimes contact with electrodes of a battery or capacitor, that is the electrical energy. Now let us have a look about the process hazard factors. There are so many factors involved in the process hazard. One is the foremost is the exothermic chemical reaction, because the continuous release of heat from the reactions. So in this case there is a strong possibility of the reaction getting out of control, that is sometimes attributed to the thermal runaway reaction. There are certain reactions, those involve the endothermicity, that is clubbed under the head of endothermic reaction. So that could react due to an external heat source such as fire or combustion or a fuel. That external heat source may be of any type of heat transfer mode. Next is the material handling in a transfer. This accounts for the hazard involved in the handling, transfer, pumping, warehousing of the material. Other is the enclosed or indoor process units. This accounts for the additional hazard where the process unit preventing dispersion of the escaped vapors. Now sometimes you may have a limited access for emergency equipment. This is again one of the factor, because sometimes these emergency equipment may lead to the safer operation, but you won't have any access to approach of those emergency equipment. So this may be a process hazard factor. Then drainage and spill. Sometimes the inadequate design of drainage would cause a large spill of flammable material adjacent to process equipment. And not only flammable material, sometimes the toxic material may also be gone through the drainage. So better housekeeping is always essential, and if you are not performing the better housekeeping, that means it is contributing to the process hazard factor. Now let us have a look about the consequences. Now here there are various adverse consequences are listed, and they are divided into three different aspects, like human impact, environmental impact and economic impact. So human impact enlisted the consumer injuries, the community injuries, sometimes the toxic or flammable material may escape to the atmosphere, and it may have a severe impact to the person, those who are living at the vicinity of that particular plant. Sometimes on-site personal injury, sometimes the unit personal injury, then sometimes it may lead to the loss of employment because of the permanent disability, etc. There may be certain psychological effect, because sometimes the accident or hazard may have impact on their subconscious mind. So these are the several human impacts. Now next is the environmental impact. Now there may be a chances of off-site contamination, may be attributed to the air, water and soil. Then on-site contamination, that is again attributed to the air, water and soil. That means they may have the adverse impact on the atmosphere, whether it is on-site or off-site. Then there are certain economic impacts, like property damage. Fire may lead to the property damage. Then inventory losses, there are several incidents where there is a huge impact on inventory losses. So this may create the environment, economic impact. Then production outage, the reason is that whenever you lost your machinery, you lost the inventory, you lost the property, then definitely there will be a production outage. Then lost market share, because when you are out of production, then definitely your product will not come out to the market, then you may lose your market share. The legal liability, is attributed to equally attributed to the human impact as well as the environmental impact, because something if releases to the atmosphere, or any worker or any nearby person may get contaminated, then definitely you need to pay the legal compensation or legal impact. Then the negative image, is again very important, because when you fail your in your goal, or you fail to provide the safer environment, or you fail to provide the safe product to the market, then definitely you may enjoy the negative image in the society, as well as your consumer, as well as the workers. Now there are several examples of hazard and their effect. It is again enlisted in terms of three aspects, that is workplace hazard, example of hazard and example of harm caused. Like things, knife cut, it may lead to the cut. If you have a substance like benzene, then it may produce the leukemia, or it may be create the carcinoma. Then material, there may be some mycobacterium tuberculosis, then it may lead to the health hazard. Source of energy, sometimes electricity, you may have electrical shock, and sometime it may lead to death. And the condition, sometimes the workplace conditions are not up to the mark. One example is that wet floor, then you may slip or fall down. There may be a process like welding, then metal fume fever, and sometimes the spark may create the flammability aspect. Then again the practice, sometimes hard rock mining, that may create the problem of silicosis. Then behavioral problem like bullying, example, the anxiety, fear, depression. So these are the certain example of hazard and their effect. Now let us have a look at what is the purpose of hazard identification and control policy. In the previous slides, we had a discussion that what kind of different hazard present at your workplace and what is the impact to the society. So the purpose of this particular procedure, because there are so many variables in workplace and in and around on-site or off-site, then we have to go for a systematic process hazard identification, and we must have a systematic control policy. So the purpose of this procedure is to provide the procedure that so far as is reasonable, practicable, integrate different type of identification, reporting and investigation of foreseeable hazard related to the work activities, and in consultation with the workers, the timely elimination or minimization of risk to health and safety, using the hierarchy of risk control. So you must adopt the proper identification and control policy. Another objective or the purpose is to ensure there is a formal process of hazard identification and risk assessment, which will effectively manage the hazard that may occur within the workplace. Now, let us discuss about the hazard identification protocol. Now, hazard identification and risk assessment are something combined into a general category that is called the hazard evaluation. Now, risk assessment is sometimes called the hazard analysis, and this risk assessment procedure that determines the probabilities is frequently called the probabilistic risk assessment, PRA, whereas a procedure that determines the probability and consequences is called the quantitative risk analysis. So, hazard identification can be performed independent of risk assessment. So, these two things are altogether independent. Now, let us have a look of the probabilistic risk assessment, that is PRA. So, this requires a rigorous technical discipline. Now, the rigorous technical discipline that has been used in the country complex technological and applications such as airline industry or a nuclear power plant, because they are having extreme hazards. Now, this technological application to reveal design, operation and a maintenance aspect, and this may lead to the safety and reduce the cost. So, risk in PRA is feasible detrimental outcome of an activity or action. Now, usually risk is characterized by two quantities. One is the magnitude, that is the severity of the possible adverse consequences, and second is the likelihood, that is called the probability of occurrence of each consequences. So, the probabilistic risk assessment usually answer three basic questions. One is that what can go wrong with the studied technological application, or what are the undesirable starting event leading to adverse consequences. Second is that what and how severe are the possible impairments or the adverse consequences that the technological entity may be eventually subjected to as a result of occurrence of the initiator. And the third and the last basic question is that how likely to occur these undesirable consequences, or what are their probabilities or frequencies. So, you must answer all three basic questions in order to get the proper risk assessment. So, this now question arises how we can formalize this process. So, the PRA process is usually as follows. First is that objective of risk assessment must be well defined. You must well define that what is the objective of that particular risk assessment. Now, associated with the objective, there may be certain unwanted consequences. So, unwanted consequences of interest must be identified and selected, including item like degrees of harm to human, that may be injuries and sometimes illness, sometimes into the fatalities, or degrees of losses of a mission. Then second is the familiarization with the system under analysis covering all relevant design and operation information, including engineering and process drawing, as well as the operating and emergency procedures. Now, next to complete the set of important initiation event, that is the triggering of event or trigger event for each series of mishaps leading to the end state, that must be identified. There may be, you need to perform certain uncertainty analysis. So, these uncertainty analysis are performed with the evaluates the degree, which evaluates the degree of knowledge or confidence in the calculated numerical risk result. Sometimes Monte Carlo simulations are used for this particular purpose. Now, sensitivity analysis are performed, which indicates with what input changes are the analysis result most sensitive to. So, after completion of this PRA, special techniques are often used to identify what led what lead contributor to risk in that particular accident consequences. Last but not least, it must be mentioned that various type of data must be collected and processed for the use throughout the PRA process. Now, next is the quantitative risk analysis, that is the second part. The formal and systematic approach to estimate the likelihood and consequences of harmful procedures and expressing the results quantitatively as to risk to people, environment or in business. This is the basic aspect of this QRA. Now, this assesses the robustness and validity of quantitative results by identifying critical assumptions and risk driving elements. Now, usually studies are typically required for the construction and processing facilities, high pressure pipelines and storage facilities at important sites including LPG, LNG, etc. Now, this contributes to improved decision making by highlighting the accident scenario that contributes most to overall the risk. Now, this the objective of quantitative risk analysis study is to identify the hazard associated with facility, to determine the potential frequencies and consequences of the identified hazard, to determine the system availability of the protection system, to quantify the risk associated with the facility, that is the risk contours, individual risk per annum, potential loss of life PLL and maybe by FN plots. Now, to suggest the recommendation in order to reduce the risk to human life, assets, environment and business interruptions to as low as reasonably practicable. So, let us adopt a certain strategy for hazard identification. So, before applying any strategy, one should always ask the different questions, that is, when is one required and how do I conduct one? The process material characterization must be performed, identify the process hazard and hazardous conditions, you must understand the consequences on the extreme aspect. Reduce, eliminate, substitute, prevent or mitigate the hazard, proper documentation, training and managerial change must be performed. Now, there are certain information required for the process safety related information pertaining to the hazard identification. You must be much aware about the materials. Those who are present at the workplace, potential chemical interactions or probable chemical reactions that may occur in due course of time. You must know that the chemistry of the desired chemical reaction, so that you must aware about the conversion factor, you must aware about the yield, you must about you must know about the production of any side product, waste product, byproduct, etc. You must be much aware about the process variable and operating conditions like temperature, desired reaction and possibilities of any side or decomposition reactions or decomposition products, etc. Pressure with respect to the gaseous and a vapor conditions. You must have a composition of all material in question, you must have the composition of all product in question, you must have the recipe at your fingertips, what is the pH of your system. You must identify any kind of upset conditions present in the workplace. You must know or you must evaluate the thermal stability of your process. You must know that what kind of the raw materials present at your workplace, what are the different additives required, what is the purity, etc. You must know the catalyst available on site, what are the intermediate products, what are the waste streams, and as far as possible you must know the MSDS of all those material in question. So once you know that you have a knowledge about the MSDS, then obviously you will be aware about the material compatibility with other things. You must have an incident review, or you must be aware, or you must learn about the incident reviews. Now, once you have collected all these things, then question arises, how to identify the hazards. So there are few things listed in this particular aspect, that you examine the similar existing systems. So you must have a review with you, review the previous hazard analysis for similar systems. You must have a review of hazard process, hazard checklist and standards applicable to global scenario and applicable to your country in question. You must have a review of operation specifications and consider all kind of environmental factors. You must consider the human machine interface and uses mode changes. You must consider the energy flow through the system. You must consider the inherent hazardous materials. Obviously, you may get the information through the MSDS. Consider the interaction between the system components, and always use the brainstorming in teams, because sometimes you may find couple of people, those who are well versed in the such type of system, they may give the proper information and they may give the useful information. Now try to get the small scale testing and a theoretical analysis. Now, once you have gone through all these things, then you must identify the common sources of hazard, like sources and propagation path of stored energy in electrical, chemical or in the mechanical form, which we have already discussed. Sometimes mechanical moving parts may give a proper information. The material and system incompatibilities, the useful information you may have from MSDS. The nuclear radiation and electromagnetic radiation, that is infrared, ultraviolet, laser, radio frequencies, etc. The collision and subsequent problems of survival and escape. You must have a fire and explosion data. The toxic and corrosive liquid and gases escaping from containers or being generated as a result of other incidents. You must know the deterioration in long term storage. You must have a knowledge about the noise and the biological hazards. Sometimes human error may play a very vital role. So you must aware about those kind of human error in operating of the system. Sometimes software errors, they may cause severe accidents. So you must aware about all those kind of common sources of hazards. Now there are frequency classes in hazard identification. There are several sometimes with respect to the different levels. So, like frequent A, level A, the specific individual item likely to occur often in the life of an item with a probability of occurrence greater than 10 to the power minus 1 in that life, and inventory sometimes continuously experienced. Similarly, probable, that is B, will occur several times in the life of an item with a probability of occurrence that is less than 10 to the power minus 1, but greater than 10 to the power minus 2 in that life, that will occur frequently. So that is the thing. Occasional, that is likely to occur sometimes in the life of an item with the probability of occurrence less than 10 to the power minus 2, but greater than 10 to the power minus 3 in that particular life. So the chances that will occur several times. The remote, that is D, the unlikely but possible to occur in the life of an item with the probability of occurrence less than 10 to the power minus 3, but greater than 10 to the power minus 6 in that life. So, unlikely but can reasonably be expected to occur. Then improbable, that is E, so unlikely, it can be assumed occurrence, may not be experienced, but with the probability of occurrence less than 10 to the power minus 6 in that life, that is unlikely to occur, but there is a possibility. So, question arises that how we can control the hazard. Now, hazard you can control through this to various methodology. First thing is that you must identify the hazard. Then you go for the evaluation of risk and cost, go for the substitution, modification, and sometimes it may happen that you may go for the redesigning of that process, go for the application of remedy, have a continuous monitoring, then you evaluate the effectiveness of that particular hazard control methodology. So, this is the basic objective and the basic methodology of hazard control. So, in this particular module, we have discussed about the basic definitions of hazard identification, because ultimately the main motive is to go for development of process hazard checklist. We have discussed different hazard control methodologies, different process of hazard identification, etcetera. In the subsequent modules, we are going to discuss that how to evaluate the process hazard checklist. Thank you very much.